On January 8th, 2019, Elle Magazine published an article by Alejandra Pablos titled "Letter from an Imperfect Immigrant." Alejandra is an immigrant rights activist who is currently fighting her order of deportation, claiming that although she has a criminal record, it is her status as an outspoken immigrant rights activist that has caused her to be up for deportation. Here to discuss her story and what she means when she calls herself an imperfect immigrant is Alejandra Pablos. Welcome, Alejandra, and thank you for taking the time out to come and talk to us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
In this article that you published that was very well received, you wrote that you're not married, you have chosen not to have children, my sexuality is fluid, I have been arrested and I am not a dreamer, I'm highly vocal about systemic injustice, and you titled this article, "Letter from an Imperfect Immigrant." Why does all of this make you imperfect?
It makes me imperfect because I don't fit into the normal mold, the standard mold. I don't have kids. I'm not that dreamer. Again, you mentioned all of those beautiful things that people here in the United States have experienced, and additionally that I am an immigrant. If I was a U.S. citizen, I would still be facing, this dissent because I'm speaking up against these systemic oppressions that a lot of people are facing.
So you're single. Is that like not what a typical immigrant should be?
I think the reason why I use that actual identity is because we live in a world that has put us into these structures, right? We're supposed to have a parent and a mother, a dad and a mother and a kid and produce products of labor for America. And I don't want to do none of that.
So is that what the perfect immigrant is? Come work, you have children, you go home at night. I mean, I tell me what the perfect immigrant to you is.
The perfect immigrant, according to people that are anti-welcoming, are people that come here and work and that contribute to our economic situation. That's the only time you hear about good immigrants is when we contribute to the economy. Well, I don't want to contribute. If I also come here and I just want to be here, I also want to be left alone and be safe and have my human rights and fulfill those.
Did you write it all about being the imperfect immigrant? Because you said, you know, everyone has that ideal. You know, Donald Trump says, I think the ideal immigrant should come from Norway. Did you think about the color of your skin or where you came from also making you less than perfect in the eyes of people, or no?
I don't think I mentioned my melanin. Mm-hmm. And particularly, I know that I've mentioned even my experience navigating these systems in the United States as a brown immigrant versus a white immigrant are very different. And we have seen right now that they've opened up gateways for even more white immigrants to come in and reducing our legal ways to come to the United States. We see that. We see in the people right now, in the light Latinos that are speaking and that are running as well. I think it is the color of your skin. I think there is a racial component to this. Absolutely.
There absolutely is. Now, you said you feel it and you feel it differently now than you've been living in the United States since
all of my life, since I was like 6-7 months old.
So you've been living in the United States since you were 6-7 months old. You're an adult now. You've had a green card for when you turned 18, I think. Is that correct?
Sure.
And you said it's different now than it was then in how darker skinned immigrants are treated. What have you experienced personally that you feel is different now than maybe 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago when you were growing up?
Thank you for that question. I think historically now, being the organizer that I know and knowing our history and where we come from, and we know that, you know, these things have been happening to people of color, immigrants of color. But I think now personally, as you mentioned, for me personally, now there's just blatant open attacks on people without status, and even people that don't have violent crimes, right? I think just before this Trump administration, they were going after felons, not families, right? I was still considered one of those felons, but nobody was actually trying to physically rush my deportation. Until this administration, the Trump administration in 2017, mind you, I've already been in deportation proceedings since 2011. This administration under Trump used the DUI against me. Before 2017, that DUI was not on my ICE charges. So that's all the facts that I know, is that they are watching. That obstruction of justice I got arrested for in Virginia for protesting against that same system that's trying to make me disappear, those charges were dropped, but those charges are still there in my ICE paperwork.
Why do you think this is happening?
Well, I think it's been happening since 1996. They've had this long-term plan set in place with the 96 crime law. It is illegal to actually incarcerate people for civil infractions, yet we do it with detention centers. So I think that has been an ongoing process that's been snowballing, right? And now we have this white supremacist actually leading the nation who can actually use this to all of his white supremacist agenda, right? I mean, we're talking about border crisis, not only just here, but in other places of the world. People are afraid of us. People here in the United States are afraid because, again, I mean, people are fleeing from across borders in our own states and becoming migrants, migrants in our own country, fighting for reproductive health care, right? So I think it's a mixture of a lot of things, but right now it is open. Trump has made it more easier to attack poor people, people, you know, the common people, women, LGBTQ folks, non-binary, people that are just simply resisting. If we're saying no, if 21 Savage comes up on a late night show and switches up his lyrics to talk about Border Patrol, and then a few days later, he gets charged and it gets in to deportation proceedings. I mean, people are speaking up, and that's what's happening.
So you're protesting, okay? You've been here since you were 6 months old. You have a green card. You were placed in deportation. Can you tell me what happened?
So yeah, unfortunately, because of the comfort and the idea of America being the most beautiful and powerful place, is capitalism, we are distracted. I didn't know shit about what was happening in Arizona in 2011 when my probation officer called me into the office so ICE can pick me up. I had no idea that happened. I had no idea we had immigration prisons. So in 2011, when I first walked in to those processing centers and saw children and mothers in ICE boxes and then proceeded to spend the next 2 years in a private prison, that's when I was like, holy shit, I'm not even the worst off. Look at these other women, right? Like coming there from survival crimes, from being in prison for 10, 12 years, separated from their children in my own backyard. Eloy is the number one employer. I mean, those 2 years completely changed my life.
What was the underlying criminal convictions? You were already a green card holder.
So I wanted to give you, when you asked for a little bit of context, my mother naturalized with the 86 amnesty. And back in the day, we lived in Santana. We are in Little Mexico. My mom didn't know that she had to actually put in paperwork for me, which is called petitioning.
Right.
I lived all of my life being with my family, you know, going to school, all of that. We moved to Arizona and I wanted to work. And I asked my mom, how do I get to work? A social, somebody said a social. Went to go get a social at the immigration office, got my work permit, my social security that same day. But I waited 3 years until I was 18 and a half to get my actual resident card. Right. Fast forward, smoked some marijuana, got the paraphernalia, got into proceedings. Then I find out, oh, you cannot get in police contact at all within your first 5 years of your residency or they can take it away. That is my situation in a short story.
Have you tried to vacate your convictions at all?
You can't vacate nothing in Arizona.
In Arizona,
you can't expunge.
No vacating.
You can try to set aside. Right. We're in the process of doing a lot of that. That's why I can't talk a lot about some of my details in my case, because mm-hmm. that's part of the pardon, part of the clemency situation.
Right.
We're going to go back in there and try different things to protect me from deportation. But yeah, that's exactly what it was. It was a possession of paraphernalia, and there's no way. I even spent longer in jail because I was trying to fight through the citizenship of my parents, and they just said, according to our law, you just should have became a resident before the age of 18. And I'm like, well, you guys didn't give me that. They took mm-hmm. forever on your end. And they're like, that's just how the system is. And I'm like thinking in my head now, and as I speak, if the system is broken clearly, and we're not about separating families, then you fix it. Then if you know this is a daughter of citizens, you know, you stop that deportation against her and you fix the paperwork and you get it moving. But that's not what America is like. We're not here for justice. We're not here to keep families together. We're here to make money off of, you know, building up jails, deporting people. And it's just very unfortunate that I have to be here still fighting and even talking about citizenship, because I know citizenship is not going to protect me from the people that I'm fighting against right now, which is ICE, which is Border Patrol.
And you were in Elroy Detention Center. Tell me where that is and tell me what it was like day to day.
I went back to Eloy for the second time this last spring to the same detention center. Eloy Detention Center is in the backyard of Arizona, of Phoenix and Tucson. It's an hour and a half away from my home. Eloy Detention Center is a for-profit prison. It is now ran by what they want to call core civic. They can also do more than incarcerate people. They can also handle your ankle monitor or your probation afterwards. You know, this is a full spectrum system of controlling and surveillance. So CCA is that organization that's here in Arizona, and it's one of the worst detention centers as far as conditions. A lot of maybe about 5 people died the 2 years that I was there. I saw people actually leaving the detention center in body bags and to never hear about them again. There's a women, people who tried to literally cut their veins and kill themselves, and they didn't, and they would come back into the detention room again with me, again, without any support or anything like that. So those are the things we saw. We saw kids being held there, 16-year-olds being held in isolation.
Why were they in isolation?
I saw people.
Why were they put in isolation?
Because you can't hold minors in an adult detention center. But because we're about incarcerating people, we're still going to incarcerate them, but we're going to put them in an isolated place where we surveil them 24/7, because that's how you keep young people safe.
Mm-hmm. So tell me about what it was like living there day to day. What time would you wake up? How many people were in your cell with you? What were the bathroom conditions like? How was the food? What did you do all day? How did you keep yourself sane?
All right. So for those 2 years, I actually would wake up really early at 6 a.m. They force you to get up and do your bed. Even you can't sleep in. When they make you get up to make your bed, you can go back to sleep, but you can't cover yourself. It's really cold. The lights never go off. And you get served 3 times a day. The last time we have a meal is at 5:30 p.m. And the next time you see a meal is at 4 a.m. If you don't wake up at those times, you don't get food. Then you have to be forced to buy commissary food. Most people don't have money. The few people that do have money are folks that have already built roots here, right? And are maybe people that just never got documented, or people that have residencies, but like have support to spend a lot of money with commissary, which is all private people making money off of bodies there. If you do decide to get a job, you get paid like $1 or $1.25 per day to work. I remember refusing that because I talked about how dare you guys ask me to work and ask us to work here when you got people in here for not working, right? So there's no paid staff there, but the actual private contractors of CCA and the health folks. The health there is also private. It's also private. So whenever there's situations that arise, they blame each other, right? The CCA and then the health clinic, because they're two different contracts of ICE. So you eat the same stuff. You eat 3,000 plate calorie, but you don't eat nothing that's really nutritional. It's all pastas, carbs, packet frozen food. That's where I actually developed acid reflux there. And you get to go outside once a day. But other than that, you are just sitting in a big dorm of 50 women. You share a cell with another person. You share the bathroom. So you have to see each other take bathroom breaks. And you just come out to this big dorm where there's just TVs. There's 3 TVs, one for English, one for Spanish, one for sports. And you just sit idle for years and years, unless you have somebody like me. When I was there for those 2 years, I taught classes. I taught English classes. I just talked about feelings. I just organized. I was just an organizer. This time around, I talked about abortions, and I talk about systemic oppression. And women there shared how if they would have known somebody like me, they would have at least known that they had choices. They love their children, but it's about choices. And some of the mothers that do have abortions are already mothers, so they know what was best. So for them to hear somebody speak and share that, it was very, very beautiful to have conversations about reproductive justice there.
Tell me about the changes and the thoughts that went through your head that got you from, I'm just, you know, la-di-da-di-da, I didn't even know that I could even get deported, to being this amazing speaker and activist and champion of justice.
Naturally, I've always been an organizer. Ever since I was able to work at 16, I worked with kids, with young people, after school programs, and it was just always very active in my community. So once I walked in to Eloy Detention Center, and you know, a couple of months, I think, when I started just doing a lot of work and research on my case, and I was like, holy shit, they're actually gonna keep me here. Like, you have a library there. There's a library, even though the material was like 10 years old, I remember at that point. I remember just the documents from the deportation officers coming and advising you and giving you this information, and you learning stories from other women that have been there for 2, 3, 4 years. And right, I think it took me maybe like 2 months to be like, oh my goodness, I'm not coming home yet. I think, I just began building the best me that I could build under those conditions. And I started to really just focusing on how I'm going to get home and how I'm going to be able to really fight to really permanently have protection when I leave here. I knew that it was possible. Even though I didn't know when, I knew that through a bond, I could come home, which is the reason why I fear a lot, because right now at the Supreme Court level, they could be looking at a case called called pre-op case, and which is the reason why we are right now let out on bond. But if they were to reverse that, like if I ever get arrested again or if I'm ever in the hands of ICE and in detention, I can permanently be detained. So those are the things that I started to learn. And then I started to just advocate for myself. And I started sharing also with my brother. My brother at the time was in Kuwait, and my brother didn't enlist because after like a year and a half that he noticed that I hadn't come home yet, he doesn't realize, and he comes home and we start thinking about how we're gonna get me out. So my brother coming back home and my brother starting to dip into what it looked like to protest at Congressman Grijalva's and just like how to really bring me home and what was going on with my lawyer and what appeal process or like what process in my applications or what applications I could apply for. We went so many ways. We went through the deriving citizenship. We went through cancellation of removal. A lot of things are happening. So my family started getting more awoken to what was happening, and we had to get stronger in organizing. So when I came home in 2013 and we paid a bond, I immediately was drenched with a community of organizers, and I was in DC fighting for fasting for families and organizing families coming all across of the United States to talk to Congress people about why they should pass immigration reform. And that's where I began my training other people to share their stories. I've always my degree was in communication, so you're right, I do have this easiness to like public speak. And that's just how it started. I ever since I got out, I've been drenched with advancing the rights of people around me, especially women and incarcerated people. And now we're here, 2019. This last deportation or this last arrest really did level up my case to be super viral. But I think it is also because I'm able to connect my story to all of other people's stories and all those different identities. And again, it's a time where I should be scared and maybe hiding out again, but I'm not. I understand that, like, what else am I going to do? This case is going to be over one day. I have to fight all the way, and we have to put ICE on trial. I'm tired of being on trial.
Do you feel like almost like now there's more purpose in your life?
Yes, I was just a young person, right, not having a intentional, like, purpose in my life aligned with the collective and what everybody else needs, not just what I need. America teaches you to hold your head up high, do you, what you have is yours. I scratch my back, you scratch yours. That's not the world that I want to live in. I want to live in a world where you're born into universal healthcare, universal housing, into a collective alignment of like growth and healing. And yeah, I mean, it's a beautiful thing that I was able to experience all of this through incarceration, but best believe I'm the exception. I've had resources. I've had U.S. citizen families to be able to support me out of this, and not the regular person that comes into detention centers ever comes home, in a way that they can completely change their life. You know, we're talking about those people that don't get to stay with their families, people that have been deported already, people that don't get to really fight and make their voices, you know, out loud. And I get to do that. And I'm just super privileged and thankful that I'm that one.
Tell me about some of the people that you met while you were in detention that you said, this person doesn't deserve to be here.
Brad, you're talking to an abolitionist. I think that nobody deserved being in there. Nobody. Not a single person. I probably didn't even have to ask, and I didn't ask a lot of people in there why they were in there for, because I understand that anything else could have been a different consequence or a different option. Like, we didn't have to incarcerate people after, you know, smoking whatever drug they decided to smoke. You know, those are the people that I met in there, people that were surviving the war on drugs, people that were survivors of domestic violence, people that didn't want to snitch on their own family members, people that drove to work, but they had their homie in the car, so now they have smuggling charges because they were both undocumented, people who overstayed their visas and got crossing in the border. Like, you know, if I have to use the language that our oppressors use by saying there was no criminals there, that's the truth. It was people who just never had another opportunity, women who had never had any pathways to any citizenship or legalization. Because when people tell us do it the right way, there is no right way.
I've spoken to some clients who told me they felt guilty when they got to be released and they saw all the people that they met still.
No, I deserve to be released. Mm-hmm. What I feel guilty about is the fact that, again, not everybody has the resources that I got.
Right.
We, you know, not everybody had that brother that came back from the army to make sure that his sister was safe. That mom that came in and visited me and organized visits for 2 years every weekend and paid for my lawyer fees. And, you know, not everybody had those things. So I was definitely happy. And I know that all of us and I deserve to be home.
So now you got released in 2013, you said, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And you started being an activist for yourself, for others, not just immigrants, but everything, you know, the progressive left stands for, it sounds like. At what point did you get arrested again? What happened?
I had been invited to a protest against ICE, a clandestine, a very like low-key office in Virginia near their capital. And they were trying to expose the agents there that were really using like some gruesome terroristic tactics to really tear people apart. I mean, they actually broke into a house and dragged a man out of his home. So I remember that was one of the situations that happened, but we were there to highlight that, to expose them. We had a legal observer there. We didn't have any media there. It was just something for us, the community, to have a conversation with these agents, and we asked to speak to them. But as soon as we got there, they called DHS police. The center, as we knew, it was on private property. So we knew that we needed either the Chesterfield police or the owners of the building to tell us to leave, and neither of them were there. So we continued to descend and continued to continue our program at the protest. And the next thing you know it, those DHS officers, or one DHS officer, just grabbed me.
How many other people were grabbed in
that protest? I was just the only one out of the 30 or so protesters.
Why you?
There's nothing on paper, sadly, but he told me afterwards when we were at the magistrate court that he arrested me because I was the loudest, and he knew that that would dismantle the protest.
So what happened? So you got placed back into immigration detention?
I was arrested, and they let me go out that day on my own word. They let me go home. But in a week, my deportation officer called me and said, hey, we know what happened in Virginia. Virginia, ICE is trying to pick you up. You know, a lot of little details that I don't know yet if I can be able to
that's
share.
Fine.
But basically,
When did this happen?
It happened like a week. January 2018 this is when the arrest happened. March, I have my next check-in. Before that, they find out about this arrest, and the deportation officer says, they can't get you, they can't do nothing to you, but when you come to your court, come and check in with me, and I'm going to have to move some stuff around in your computer so we don't re-detain you.
Uh-huh.
Time passed, and I'm going to have to re-detain you. You're going to have to come into prison and go on bond again and appeal for a bond again. Well, that's just the way they do it.
And you want to know why? Is because it's much easier if you just walk into them than them chasing you around to go find you.
For us, we were very clear. We actually, because we do this work, we knew that they go through a risk management assessment.
Right.
So actually that day when he told me, you're going to have to come check in, I said, well, how are you going to make that calculation? And he says, we're going to put your record and your information into a risk management assessment, which Palantir makes and has made a lot of money off of making these numerical algorithms for people to be re-detained. The same services are used for bond. And that's what they use here in bond for ICE too. So he runs my record and my information. And obviously, because of this recent arrest, and because of my priors, I was obviously risk of fleeing, so I had to be mandatory detention. Mm-hmm. So that's why he took me in. And he told me, when he took me in, he didn't even want to put handcuffs on me. He's like, this is what I have to do. He goes, you know, you just have these felonies that make you, you know, mandatory detention.
And you were in detention for how long?
43 days. They paid my bond, and they still left me in the holding cell for about 4 hours before they actually let me go home.
Was it different the second time around from the first time?
I think the second time around, things just got really, really way tougher for the folks living in there. But also, I was different. So that was beautiful. Again, those conversations that I was able to have, that information, those resources, that feeling of empowerment that people actually met an activist that's actually doing this and saying these things. And they got to see pictures, and a flood of books come in every day. I passed out Spanish books to other women. They started taking away my books and saying I couldn't do that. All kinds of crap.
Right.
Whatever they could, because they were like, who is that? But for as far as us living there and me coming there for the second time, there was no way for me to produce any carbon copies of anything that I wanted to be documented, not to health, not to any complaints or grievances, or to ICE. I couldn't. There was no carbon copies this time around. Before, you were able to do a copy and your carbon copy, you keep it, blah blah blah. This time, nada. This time, if you wanted to see a doctor, you had to get up at 4:45 to go through the five and six, like, call, sick call, time. That's the only time you can go. So when I was there, my cellmate got sick and she was bleeding. It was a long process. This one day she was already bleeding really bad from her rectum, and she asked me to translate to her. And the officer that was directly supervising us said, well, did she drink water? I have to ask her that. I'm sorry, you know, because I know English. And then I'm like, yeah, no. And I'm, you know, I'm still translating. But that's the question they ask you. Did you drink water? And why didn't you go to sit call in the morning? Because if you didn't go that morning, then you have to go the next day. There is no benefit of saying I'm sick. What? They think everybody's a liar. They think we're the enemies. We come in as enemies there and as people who deserve to be treated lesser than animals, honestly. So that day, she never got to go to the doctor. I had to ask them, the supervisor in the middle, to call. She ended up calling, and they still, the healthcare was like, no, we told her already, blah, 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 or whatever it was. But this woman went to sleep crying and with blood in her rectum on the bed. And that's the type of situation
that happened. Did she get to a doctor?
I don't even know what happened. I ended up leaving maybe like 3 days after that. She already had, she was one of my newest roommates there. But those were the things. Like, you couldn't just put a request in and go see a doctor. You had to get up at 5 a.m. if you ever wanted to tell them that you were kind of sick or you may feel sick later.
Why do you think they make you do it at 5 a.m? They just don't want you to see the doctor?
They don't want to spend money on us. It's like, keep you good enough to deport you or get you out of here. We don't want to fix your problems. They blame everything on, like, you brought that out when you came here. So what? People are sick now, right? And I used to talk to the doctors. I used to say, what is your oath? I said, because the doctor actually told me, they were like, I have the answer. One of the doctors was, if they just gave 5 things to you guys when you guys came in, we wouldn't have you guys every day in here. People come in because they don't have good shoes. So they come in for foot stuff. They come in for ulcers and acid reflux because of the food.
Right.
We sit on 2-inch mattresses on metal. They come in because of back problems. They come in, you know, those are like basic things like that they don't give us because it's for profit. And again, they're not there to take care of us. So like, even the doctors know what can be done, but they can't do nothing because it's just a private contract through ICE.
If the average American heard what you just told us, they would be horrified. They don't think about what goes on in there.
It was awful. It was awful to be there, honestly. And I was just really, it was stressful. I remember one time this woman came from another CCA. From a Vegas CCA, and they wanted to give her used underwear. And she was like, no, I'm not taking this. I'm in this other CCA. We get clean clothes, we get this. And she starts just breaking it down how good. She goes, it's because you guys are not resisting. You guys are not fighting back. And I remember just being like, and I started reading her handbook and how things were different. I started comparing the handbook from CCA over there and this one. And I'm like, how can they get away with this? Like, what are the things? I'm highlighting what's different. And I just started crying. And I call an organization, the Detention Watch Network. And I'm like, I don't know. I feel like crap. I haven't been doing nothing. I'm scared, because they kept telling me, if you keep organizing inside, they're going to deny you a bond.
You see, I'm cynical. I think that if you were organizing more, they would want to get you out of there because you're causing a problem to them.
You would think. You just never know.
Yeah, you don't know. Right. If I'm the warden, I'm like, get rid of this girl. Give her the bond.
But if they really want to fuck with you, right, from somebody above, like the staff there probably don't care. But like, you know, if people are watching, like, you just don't know. I'm like, I'm already in proceedings. That's what it says on my paperwork.
They can't put you in deportation twice. I tell that to my clients all the time. Don't worry. You can't be put. You're already in deportation. They can't do it a second time.
So it's like those things that I was scared of when they were telling me. I remember being so scared. But it's this fear again, this control. Yeah. Like, I'm not going to come home. You don't know. So it was a balance, right? And it was just like a lot of healing and a lot of trauma that I had to do. But you know what? The women in there, they were waking up. They were watching news. There's a lot of more Spanish news with politic-driven messages, with more language about social justice. More organizers are popping up and activism. And these women had a lot of hope and more strength. And again, they know that they got to fight, that we can't just let the status quo keep being the way that it is. We got to resist and share our stories.
Did you find any of the guards or the people who worked in the jail sympathetic or empathetic to what you and the other inmates were going through?
Only one black woman, I'll never forget that officer, was the one that would go out of her way. That's why she never went up in rank. I even told her, I'm like, damn, you still an officer? You haven't gotten up in ranks? But it's because she always resisted and always went out of her way to give people clean clothes and talked about how unjust this was. But it's also her job, right? They put you in this world where you have to, there's no alternatives. We're asking people to quit their jobs, but there's no alternatives, right? So I think for me, it was only one person, and unfortunately, and still, she was the police. I still didn't trust her when I was there. But unfortunately, everybody is just in the status quo. They think that, you know, they're not hurting us. us, that they're just watching us, they're just doing their job. And unfortunately, they're just aiding and actually being a part of the problem.
Now you're getting support from celebrities like America Ferrera, Rosario Dawson, Alyssa Milano. Tell me about that support. Has it been helpful?
It's the first time that I actually am thinking of when it's going to be over. I do know that this deportation case is going to be over. I do know that I'm here safely for another 1 to 3 years in appeals, regardless of my own strategies to get a pardon. But that's what we're going to be doing. We're figuring out right now all the best scenarios and all the best legal support that we can get to start this process of a pardon. Here in Arizona, again, you can't expunge. So even if you want to get a pardon, you can't just go pick up a pardon packet just like in other states. You have to actually go to trial in front of a clemency board that's assigned by Ducey, and then have to appeal to them. But I think we're in a very good situation. I think as an organizers, where it's about us pushing the narrative and really addressing some really tough topics. And I think that in Arizona, we haven't done a lot of pardons, and we're ready for that. A lot of people here are ready for some real heavy reform.
Is the governor amenable, or has he not really been giving any pardons in Arizona?
He's only given one. But also, we think it's because people just don't know they can do that. The only pardon he's given was to this one person who stole a motorcycle bike or something a long time ago, and he wanted to get his gun rights back, and he gave him a pardon.
Oh, for a gun. So, for a gun, yes. Crazy.
But, you know, some ally friends here in Arizona had said that even if Ducey decided to dismiss my criminal record and all this other things that I'm against, that he's not going to give me a pardon because of my abortion advocacy. So now he's just invited the whole abortion world to fight behind me.
You're an amazing woman, and quite frankly, you know, America should have more women like you, not less. Where can we find out more about your fight and to help you here in the United States?
I'm always sharing my story and sharing workshops. So I'm all around the world right now. Well, the United States. So if y'all want to see me close up and have some more deeper conversations, definitely hit me up at keepalefree.org and we can connect and work together.
Well, we wish you the best of luck. I hope it really turns out for you. You're really an amazing speaker. You have so much to say, important, smart things to say. I'm sorry that you're going through this, but I hope it turns out well for you.
Let's sign the petition when we ask Ducey and to show support for this clemency trial. We're going to hit you guys up to support in that, too.
My pleasure. Where do you see the future for you and this country? And what would you, you know, in the most perfect world, what would be your dream?
I think that I am an organizer because I am striving for a world without poverty and a world that makes space for folks, that instead of incarceration, we have support systems. So I think that a world that is just for me looks like a world that has the most impacted, most marginalized people at its forefront. And I think it also envisions also a world that where democracy doesn't look like it looks like right now. It looks different. It looks like getting rid of the electorate college, for one, to begin with. But it looks like where there's no for-profit. There is no profit being made over bodies. And we are the most powerful, richest country. We have enough to do universal housing and universal healthcare for people. So my dream is that we work towards that. And I think I started seeing a lot of universal healthcare conversations already this year. But does that universal healthcare, am I an American? Does that include us? We want to talk about all of us.
Alejandra Pablos, thank you very much. We wish you the best of luck, and we'll be checking in on you and hopefully hearing some positive things.
Thank you.
Thank you.